We can go. The book of Second Chronicles was originally one book with First Chronicles in the Hebrew text. They were divided by the translators of the Septuagint and were entitled things that were left behind. You know, an example, and bear with me, I'm repeating myself. Things that are left behind, details not included in the books of Samuel 1 and 2, Kings 1 and 2. The Hebrew title actually meant daily matters, like the English title implies, an inspiration and detailed narrative account. And it was written by the priest of Israel. The books of Chronicles view Israel's religious institutions, and this is how it all started, from Moses with the commandments, all the frustration, all the trials and tribulations and afflictions that they all went through, is noted in the beginning of the Bible, and how the family lines were all corrupted, and it's no different today. Some of our own enemies are in our own houses. So it's an interesting study to bring us into the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. And as I said a moment ago, they still set the table in the Jewish household for their Messiah, but they missed the boat on it because he came, he went, and he's going to come again. There's going to be a multitude of Jewish people in the latter times being saved. I've been witnessing it as long as I've been a Christian. Today's read is not a big read, but it shows you, like part of our warfare prayer, how good our God is to all of us. The historical lesson here, the essential elements of the national life of the Israelites. The individual reigns of the descendants of David or Richard from the time of Solomon until the fall of Jerusalem under Zedekiah in 580 BC, a concluding note concerning the edict of Cyrus the Great permitting the Jews to return to Jerusalem is added at the end. Through 1 and 2 Chronicles, the emphasis is strictly on the southern kingdom of Judah, whose fortunes were viewed in light of her faith. The fullness is in God's commandments and the institutions of Israel's religious faith. And, you know, our faith today is in Jesus Christ, in him alone. And all we got to do is believe what he did when he said, Father, forgive them, they know not what they do. He became that one-time sacrifice for all sinners. Whole different perspective, because it was the schoolmaster bringing us to Christ. The law was the schoolmaster. That's the only way I can explain it. I'm not reading this all out of commentary. This is coming out of my heart. I've been studying this for quite a few years. It's my opinion. But although the book's major theme is that Judah is falling because of internal weakness brought about by her failure, and guess what Israel's failure was? To be faithful to God, to trust and obey. In the case of Ezra's authorship is well established in Jewish tradition. He was of a priestly descent, a Levitical training, as well as being spiritual leader of the new state of Judah under the return from Babylon captivity, that he would have had access to the records of state and other official documents. So this is all historical, but there are critical arguments for a third century, and this is coming out of my Thomas Nelson Study Bible, are totally unwanted. Besides, the need for such a book to establish national credibility was very much crucial for Ezra's community than for the Hamonian leaders in the second century BC. So in speaking this morning, that's the intro out of the Thomas Nelson Second Edition Study Bible, along with some of my heart. The reading is very short, brothers and sisters. It's 17 verses, but wonderful read. I really enjoy it. Let me see if I can shed some light this way. See a little better. Yeah, that's good. And the Word of God is the Word of God. Solomon's kingdom is now going to be established here in the first chapter. And what it showed me when I was studying this morning for a little bit before I opened the prayer group was the fact that what we cry out to God for every day in the daily warfare prayer, God makes it happen the same way he made it for Solomon. He makes it for all of us that cry out to God for help. And he uses the way he used David all the time with all of us. Let me begin to read. I pray that you have eyes to see, ears to hear. If you have your Bible, you can follow verse by verse. And I'm going to expound a little on it as I'm reading it. Because there's really not much here in the Thomas Nelson. There's one little paragraph, but it's the way that God presented this first chapter. It teaches us to communicate with God. And Solomon, the son of David, was strengthened in his kingdom, and the Lord his God was with him and magnified him exceedingly. And that's a great way to start the read today, because when you have a one-on-one relationship in the Word of God and you talk to God about Scripture and you have a conversation with God and you lean not on your own understanding, but you take in the Word of God as God directing you, it can be an amazing journey. And I'm not being boastful. I've had to correct a lot of things in my Christian walk over the last 37 years. In fact, I said to the sister at church, I've been a believer longer than she's been alive. She had two children and she was only 26 years old. And she said, well, Pastor, when you express it, I understand it because you're very passionate about the Word of God. Well, we're all supposed to be passionate about God's Word. It's the truth, the way, and the life, people. Verse 2, listen to what Solomon spoke. Then Solomon spoke unto all Israel, to the captains of the thousands and of hundreds, and to the judges, and every governor in all Israel, the chief of the fathers. So Solomon and all the congregation with him went to the high place that was at Gibeon, for there was the tabernacle of the congregation of God, which Moses, I mentioned Moses earlier in our conversation, the servant of the Lord, had made in the wilderness. Remember something, he went up to that mountain, to the burning bush, and he listened explicitly to what God told him to do. So when we read the Bible, we need to pay attention. We need to hearken unto the Word of God, because there's so many pearls from the beginning of the book to the end of the book, brothers and sisters. Verse 4, but the ark of God had David brought up from Kirjath, Jearim, in the place which David had prepared for it, for he had pitched a tent for it at Jerusalem. So, you know, and you're going to see as we continue in scriptures over the next couple of months, how this thing all started out of a tent. And it's amazing. When God can take the word of God and feed his sheep, as you begin to digest and walk and climb God's mountain, it's all spiritual, brothers and sisters. And that's when you see the goodness of God. Moreover, there was a brazen altar that Bezaleel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, had made. He put before the tabernacle of the Lord, and Solomon and the congregation sought unto it. And Solomon went up thither to the brazen altar before the Lord, which was the tabernacle of the congregation, and he offered 1,000 burnt offerings upon it. Now, you get real here. I'm trying to share this. That's why it's the schoolmaster. We'd be there forever doing 1,000 burnt offerings, people. Most people can't even handle a two-hour sermon or fellowship in a building before they get antsy. But imagine this. Well, he offered 1,000 burnt offerings upon it. That was on the altar. You can make your own choice. Huh? I'm grateful to God that he did a one-time sacrifice. And we're forgiven. And all we got to do is believe in that. You know, people want to argue about this. Don't argue with anybody, please, brothers and sisters. Jesus Christ is God. And in him, all things were created. And that's a big mouthful to digest. And that's where faith comes in. And we're supposed to walk with the King. And with Christ, you take in the word of God and you get up and walk with him and you become a doer of the word. It's not difficult. He says, take my yoke upon you. It's easy. Learn from me. So you got to learn from the word of God. And that's why you can do all things through Christ. It's called decision-making. Whose report are you going to believe? Verse 7. In that night did God appear unto Solomon. I bet anyone here, if God appeared to any one of us, boy, we'd be totally all aboard, even including what I wrote, you know, about the title of my message yesterday. We overcome Satan by the blood of the Lamb, word of our testimony. We all know the rest. And you love not your life unto death. That's why the early church, they didn't raise a hand. They knew they were going to go home. They knew the earth wasn't their home and there was going to be a better place for eternity. There's not a lot of Christians that believe like that right now. And Solomon said unto God, thou hast showed great mercy unto David, my father, and has made me to reign in his stead. Verse 9. Now, O Lord God, let the promise unto David, my father, be established, for thou hast made me king. Remember, God's the one that made him king. He says, for thou hast made me king over a people like the dust of the earth in multitude. Now here's the key. Verse 10. Get your heart stirred up here. Because you got the same God that Solomon had. And listen to Solomon's words here. Because this really penetrated my heart this morning when I studied this little chapter. Because of the way it's written to all of us. Solomon must have been there in the secret place. And he said, give me now wisdom and knowledge that I might go out and come to before this people. For who can judge this people that is so great? Verse 11. And God said to Solomon, because this was in thine heart, and thou hast not asked for what? Riches, wealth, or honor, nor the life of thy enemies. Didn't even want him to kill his enemies. Neither you've asked for long life. Kind of goes along with my Sunday message. See, when you're really tuning in to God, he's going to do for you and I what he's doing in this read today. Okay, I'm going to read this twice through, but let me finish it. But has asked wisdom and knowledge for thyself, that thou mayest judge my people over whom I've made thee a king. Today, we have to be a servant to everyone. Today, we're a royal priesthood, servants of the Most High God. Once again, I want to read verse 11 so you get it into your spirit. And God said to Solomon, because this was thine heart. First thing I want you to establish, get your heart right with God this morning. And thou hast not asked, it's not about riches, wealth, or honor, nor the life of the enemies. Neither ye have asked for long life, because it doesn't matter how long you live. It matters that you believe in God. It matters that you have eternal life, brothers and sisters. In other words, you're saved, you're born again, you put your faith in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is the New Testament. Jesus Christ is the Word of God that became flesh. So none of us have an excuse. And he says here, but as asked, you ask for wisdom and knowledge. So that's all we got to do is ask God for wisdom and knowledge. And he gives it to us freely, brothers and sisters. Thou mayest judge my people over whom I've made thee a king. Verse 12. Wisdom and knowledge is granted unto thee, and I will give thee, listen to what God says he's going to do. I will give thee riches and wealth and honor, such as none of the kings have had before thee. Neither shall there any after thee have the like. Look what happened in one really deep, sincere conversation. You know, and Solomon made a lot of mistakes too. You'll see that as we continue to study. But because his heart was right, God blessed him. And neither shall there any after thee have the like. The subtitle on the last four verses, easily spoken out of the Thomas Nelson this morning. Then Solomon came from his journey to the high place that was at Gibeon to Jerusalem from before the tabernacle of the congregation and reigned over Israel. And Solomon, he gathered all the chariots and horsemen, and he had 1,400 chariots and 12,000 horsemen, which he placed in the chariot cities and with the king at Jerusalem. And the king, verse 15, made silver and gold at Jerusalem as plenteous as stones and cedar trees. Made he as the sycamore trees that are in the vale for abundance. Verse 16 today, and Solomon had horses brought out of Egypt, and linen, yarn. The king's merchants received the linen yarn at a price. And they fetched up and brought forth out of Egypt a chariot for 600 shekels of silver, and a horse for 150, and so brought they out horses for all the kings of the Hittites, and for the kings of Syria by their means. And that says, that closed. So let me open the, oh, I put it down. I used it this morning. It's over here. Grab you the short commentary, Thomas Nelson. I want to get ahead of myself this morning. Second Chronicles 1, God, the ruler, God exalted him exceedingly. In other words, Solomon could strengthen his kingdom, but only God could exalt his name. If Solomon had tried to exalt himself, God would have disciplined him. 1 Peter 5:5. Solomon's hands were filled. He was a worshiper. Solomon's hands were filled with sacrifices for the Lord. His ears were open to the word of the Lord. His heart was devoted to the service of the Lord. The great desire was to be capable of serving the people with wisdom. How much do we need wisdom, brothers and sisters? You know, a friend of mine wrote a song many years ago, a sister in the band, Christians, and she said, it's a beautiful song. I have some CDs up in the attic. And it went like, I need your wisdom. And she sang it to the Lord. And how much more would God give us if we cry out to him? And all you got to do is sit at his feet and pay attention to the words of God. I spoke that on the pulpit yesterday about Proverbs giving us wisdom. His great desire was to be capable of serving his people with wisdom. As ambassadors for Jesus Christ, we need to serve God using the wisdom of God, which is the word of God, brothers and sisters. Have you done what James 1:57 tells us to do in the book of James? You know, I opened up yesterday's teaching out of James, but I didn't hit everything. I said, I'll maybe next week go back in and teach a little more about wisdom and understanding our good Lord up above. But what happened here? Because Solomon was a king and he wanted wisdom from God. God said, I know what I'm going to do with you. And he granted that desire. God did. Have you asked God today, real time, brothers and sisters? Because I need his wisdom. It gives me a passion to talk to people about the goodness of God. And King Solomon had a flair. That's why he brought in stuff from Egypt. He was into the foreign trade. You know, real time, our country today, foreign relations. I mean, and sometimes that gets you in a jam because look at, we outsourced everything and now we're dependent on non-believing countries. So there's a lot here in all of this. King Solomon had a flair for foreign trade in spite of the abomination in Deuteronomy 17, verses 16 and 17, he amassed from his father silver and gold and multiplied the horses. David had only 100 chariots. We go back to 1 Chronicles 18:4, but his son Solomon added another 1,300. Trade brought wealth to the nation. But it may have been the beginning of Solomon's downfall. Just like America right now. You know, when I read this morning, I was really beaming on how strong is God's wisdom. How strong is, we've got a whole book loaded with the grace of God. You know, and how many people really use their Bible as a go-to instruction book for all the situations we get ourselves ensnared in. Remember, the earth is not our home. There's a God of this world. His name is Satan. We all know that. And we're to take thoughts captive by the word of God, not by our own opinion. We can't lean on our own understanding. We have to lean on God's word, brothers and sisters. And sometimes ill fares the land when we're listening like a prey. In other words, the enemy is playing with us. because he's saying, look at your kids. Look at your kids. They're not doing as you say. And that's what we have. We have the accuser. That's the devil's full-time gig right now. Accusing us, accuser of the brethren. Where wealth accumulates, brothers and sisters, men decay. Why? Because you can't love God and love money. I'll finish with my other commentary here. I didn't give it much time this morning. I looked at the first page and I said, oh, gotta keep it simple. But I got into the end of the first page on Second Chronicle introduction here, and in the other commentary I like using, and he says, our God is sovereign. We are not going to make God do anything. God does have a program. He's not going to change his program for you or me. The important thing is for you and me to get into step with God. I tell you, the will of God comes out of eternity down through the centuries, moves through the centuries unto eternity. God pity the little man who gets in front of the steamroller. It will go right over you. And that's why it's important to study to show yourself approved. Someone will be sure to say he doesn't like that. May I remind you that we are creatures and we have a creator. The creature does not get God to do something. It is God who's trying to get us to do something. That's basically the big problem here in the world right now. We want what we want instead of doing what God says to do. It's not God's duty to obey us. It's our duty, brothers and sisters, to obey God. And you know, when I read that this morning, what else could I say to everybody? You know, when he said, give me wisdom and knowledge that I may go out and come in before the people who can judge this, the people that is so great, that was verse 10, today's read. Here's the commentary. People commend Solomon and say that he was too smart to ask for wisdom. God gave him credit for asking. But where did he get the idea? If we turn back to chapter 22 of 1 Chronicles, David said to Solomon, my son, as for me, it was in my mind to build a house unto the name of the Lord, my God. But the word of the Lord came to me saying, thou hast shed too much blood abundantly and has made great wars. Thou shalt not build a house. So what does that tell us? God was in control, even though David wanted to be in control. And the Lord be with thee and prosper thee and build the house. And that's what David ministered to his son. Okay. And at least Solomon was listening to his father. When David said, the Lord give thee wisdom and understanding, he remembered. So when the Lord asked, what do you want? Solomon said, I need wisdom and understanding. And God, who's sovereign, gave him credit for that just by speaking it. How much more does God want to help you and I? But you got to have that relationship. That comes with our prayer life, praying for other people, fasting for other people, doing the things that God tells all of us to do. The word of God doesn't return void. Sometimes we don't pay attention. God grants his request for wisdom and gives him other blessings besides. I want you to notice that the request did not ask for spiritual discernment, we will see that Solomon lacked spiritual discernment as we continue to read in Solomon's own life. And that's where commentaries really help you get an understanding that we all have hiccups. We all make mistakes. Although he was given divine wisdom to rule, he did not have wisdom to keep his own personal life in order, brothers and sisters. And then, you know, I never knew this until I looked at the commentary on the sycamore tree. And you know, the sycamore tree grows over there today, but you don't see many cedar trees. He made cedar trees as abundant as the sycamore, silver and gold like the stones. If you've ever been in that land, and I've never been to Israel, if you know that there are rocks and stones, and those are the pictures I just witnessed from my mechanic. He went and got baptized in the Jordan. It's on my smartphone, and he was so excited because there's many rocks in the land over there, more so than any other place I've ever seen. This is commentary. Imagine Solomon making silver and gold as a common place as all those stones. And I could actually send you guys pictures of all the stones. I mean, it's all you see over there. It's pretty amazing. You will notice he is getting into an area which was forbidden to him at the end. God had told him when the day should come that they would have a king, he shall not multiply horses to himself, nor cause the people. This is how it ended, the first chapter of Second Chronicles. Nor so the people could return to Egypt, to the end that he should multiply horses, for as much as the Lord had said unto him, you shall henceforth return no more that day, neither shall he multiply wives to himself, and his heart turn not away, neither shall he greatly multiply, and it closes here, to himself silver or gold. And on your own dime, go back and look at Deuteronomy chapter 17, verse 16 and 17, because that was plugged in on today's read as a scripture to just meditate on. Solomon was amassing horses, and he is becoming personally wealthy. And that's what happens. My wife and me were talking about that yesterday. The love of money is a bad place to be because it takes our eyes off of what, you know, you either got to love God, you can't love the both. You got to make a choice in your life this day whom you're going to serve. So I hope this teaching bless someone out here today. God bless you all. And it was a good opener. Record.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all it's stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. recipe. Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would going on to if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way where there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can say. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about guilty. Who would care that much about me? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way where there ain't no way. Rise.